Welcome to Wednesday Night Victorious Living. What an excited group. I love it. I love it. So we're continuing our study, and actually we will close out our study on offense. Aren't you glad? It's been a little rough, hasn't it? But have you learned something? Absolutely. And tonight we're going to take all of the information that we've learned and put it into how. How do I move forward? So that's where we're going tonight. So let's open with prayer, and we're going to let God, the Holy Spirit, lead. Father, in Jesus' name, we give you all the honor and glory, Jesus, for all the testimonies. God, you are on the move. You are moving in lives, in bodies, in families, and in our community. And we are so excited. Holy Spirit, we invite you in to permeate this place. Holy Spirit, you be the teacher and instructor. And we expect a mighty move of God for change and moving forward. In Jesus' name. Have you ever noticed how many people walk around in their life offended? Have you noticed that? And has this topic opened your eyes and opportunities to stay out of offense? The answer was supposed to be yes.
Yes.
It's impossible that no offenses should come, but woe. many hours of rehab to pull all the muscles back together in his knee, and he couldn't walk for days. So his physical therapist said to him, "This would not have happened if you had been exercising regularly. Because your muscles were out of shape, you are more prone to injury." So once he was able to walk, he was instructed, "You must do these exercises to bring your knee muscles back into proper shape and condition." It took months to get his knee back to normal. So you may be asking, what in the world does that have to do with the fence? Well, take your Bible or your Bible app and go to Acts 24:16. On your outline tonight, as always, is all of your scriptures in order. Acts 24:16. I love how the Word of God touches every area of our life and instructs us. And this is one. "And herein do I exercise myself, to have always a conscience void of offense toward God and toward men." Where did that perfect verse come from? Isn't that amazing? It takes effort to stay out of offense. Paul compares it to exercising. If we exercise our body, we will be less prone to injury. Paul is saying, if we exercise ourselves, we will stay away from offense. Could this physical rehab possibly give us some a greater understanding that it is the same for offense, that we need to exercise to stay out of it? So exercise is training and discipline. And usually none of us like that. Have you noticed? Exercise essentially is for us to stay in shape and not be prone to injury, but we don't always like it. However, it's important that we do it diligently and regularly. We must exercise our heart and emotions so that we are in condition to handle offense when it comes, so no permanent injury will have permanent damage as a result. Now, we all know that exercise takes time, takes work, but if we do it, we will be better in better shape. There we go. And so we won't be a candidate for rehab. So tonight we're going to say we are all candidates for rehab. So let's enter. Let's learn to change for the better and get into condition so we're not hurt by others. Does that sound good? Yeah. And you know what? This is going to change our life. Offenses. We get hurt. Our emotions begin to put a little extra strain on us, don't they? And it causes wounds, it causes injuries, and some will last for years and separate relationships for many, many decades. But to be healed and free, it takes a lot of work, but it is all worth it. So maybe you're saying, "Well, I'm not an offense. I let that go a long time ago. I'm fine." But can I tell you, if you have noticed some symptoms creep up, if you feel like you're fighting the devil tooth and nail every day, maybe you're lonely, maybe you're tormented. Does it seem like your joy is being stolen every time you turn around? Are you continually fighting in anger? Do you feel like you're rebuking the devil all the time, like Joyce Meyer says, till your rebuker has worn out? And do you feel hurt and in a victim mentality? May I suggest that perhaps not everything is healed and free regarding that offense? You know, sometimes we get Entered rehab, right?
Yeah.
And we want to be whole and know why? Because my flesh is being quiet for once. It's amazing when we deny our flesh, our spirit man, that's the God part of us, sharpens up and can begin to hear his voice. And it is at this point that our flesh backs up and God's spirit begins to move and begins to speak and heal. I would suggest to you, pray, ask God if a fast is what you need to hear from him in a certain area, to break the bondages, to break the oppression and the burdens. Now, rehab can be difficult. It's awakening areas of the body that have been broken or suppressed, and it takes some difficult exercises to prepare them to be in working order again. So our next exercise is to begin to pray for the person that has hurt you. Everybody say, ouch. Now, does that make you want to go screaming out of the room, "But you don't know what they did to me"? Rehab isn't always easy. But essentially, the goal is that we'll be healthy and whole again. So what we must do is press through, even when it's difficult, even when we don't want to. Because when our flesh doesn't want to, we've got to keep in mind, we're on the road to recovery, aren't we? So at first, your prayer for that person that hurt you may not sound too spiritual, may not sound too spectacular, and it may not be with a lot of feeling. But you know what? That's okay. Because your feelings, your emotions, the God part of you is going to catch up, but you're stepping out on faith. Depending upon the extent of your wound, you may be still vulnerable. So at this point, you exercise even when you don't feel like it. That's faith. So you pray, and with each effort, it's strengthening your heart, your mind, your emotions. Why? To prevent further injury. That's good, isn't it? Your prayer might sound something like this: "Lord, I forgive them. I pray that you bless them and they'll have a good day. Amen." Now that's not much of a prayer, is it? But you know what? God knows the motive of your heart and its effort. It's effort. Rehab is beginning where you are and preparing us for where we need to go. I need to say that again. Rehab is beginning where you are and preparing you where you need to go. Go to Matthew 5. Jesus is speaking to us here. Matthew 5:43. I'll give you just a moment to look that up. Matthew 5:43. How's it going for you? Is it going okay? You doing all right? Okay. Good. You're still here. No one has gone screaming out of the room. You're thinking it, but you're not doing it. Good. Look what Jesus said in Matthew 5:43. He said, "You have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies. Bless those who curse you. Do good to those who hate you. Pray for those who spitefully use you and persecute you." There will be people who might chime in while you're in rehab and say, "You have every right to be offended. They hurt you. Besides, look what they did." But it's pretty clear what Jesus is saying, isn't it?
Yeah.
So let me ask a question. What about relapses? Are you still up, and you must keep on doing it diligently. And the exercise Jesus is talking about is forgiving and blessing. Wow. Keep the exercises up. So there will be something else that comes up during rehab. Fight off the old thoughts. You know, that old thinking that got us to where we are? While we're exercising, we are going to have to learn to reject those thoughts that we've had in the past. You know those thoughts. They hurt my feelings. I can't stand them. I don't want to be around them. They're terrible.
Sometimes you feel like it's
it's just easier to go with the flow. Because rehab is too hard. I'd rather just walk around with a limp than go through late rehab. Really? Seriously? I bet you don't. So listen to this example. If you're rowing a boat on a river against the current, you will have to row continuously in order to make progress against the flow up the river, right? In the picture? But what if you stop rowing and relax? You're going to eventually, what? Flow with the current. Just going to go with the flow. So when we are determined to go God's way, how determined are you? I would say you're determined because you're here on a Wednesday night. So I would say you're pretty determined. So as you are determined to go God's way, there will be obstacles where it just seems so much easier to just go with the flow. There will be obstacles, there will be challenges, and the world will say, oh, just go with the flow. There's a level that God wants you and I to strive for. And we only can get there with His help. And that level is where we're going to go higher with Him, no matter what the obstacle is. No matter how many times we have to humble ourselves and forgive, this degree allows us to flow with Him. How's that sound? Rather than going with the flow of the world. And that is, precious one, with His perfect character. You know, we talked about the fighting fruit last week. That's God's character, the fruit of the Spirit. He wants us to not look at the offense, but God wants to do something wonderful in the situation. It will allow Him. What's He going to do? Well, I'll guarantee you He's going to change us from the inside out. And isn't that what rehab is about? Rehab is personal. It's not about the other person. Who's it about? It's about me, myself, and I. Take your Bible and go to 1 Peter 4. 1 Peter 4:12. Ah, this is good. What we just talked about, this scripture nails it. 1 Peter 4:12. Dear friends, don't be surprised. This is the New Living Translation, by the way. Don't be surprised at the fiery trials you're going through. Okay? So don't be surprised. As if something strange were happening to you. Verse 13, instead, be very glad. For these trials make you partners with Christ in His suffering, so that you will have the wonderful joy of seeing His glory when it is revealed to all the world. How is it going to be revealed to all the world? What? Through us? Wow. You mean all this rehab isn't for just nothing? No, there's a purpose. And that purpose is, there's people that's an audience about what we're going through. There are people that are watching and going, I know what they're going through. I know what happened to them. How are they doing this? And we need to brag on our God. And we're not getting into offense. We're healthy and strong and peaceful. And we've got this wonderful joy seeing His glory when it's revealed to all the world. And then we get to say, it's not me, it's Jesus. Let me tell you what Jesus did. Let me tell you, for me, this was Jesus. He did this and He did that. It's not about us. We've learned in rehab already to get our eyes off ourselves. It's not about us. to, right? But it's all about what Christ does within us, through us, and the joy we feel. And we can see His glory, which is His goodness, and it's revealed in the situation. Did you get that? It's revealed in the situation. So instead of us going off in a corner and looking at wounds, they hurt me, they did this to me, they said that about me, then we do all the things that we've talked about tonight, and then we see God change the situation, turn it all around for His glory and goodness. So we've been in rehab. It's time for us to be released from rehab. But we need to have some take-home exercises to help us stay diligent with our restoration. Are you ready for your take-home restorator, take-home exercise? Number one, choose. Choose when the opportunity to be offended comes. Choose right then and there not to react. Choose the fact, I will not be offended. I choose to forgive. And I'm not going to allow this to hinder my relationship with Jesus or others. That's pretty good, right? Now, that all rolls off the tongue really easily. Except when you have to do it in the middle of offense. But you know what? It does take practice. And isn't that what those exercises are about? Number two, change. We've got to change our attitude. We cannot let anger be our go-to emotion. We cannot not let our feelings lead, our emotions lead, and sway our decision to stay out of offense. Because emotions, oh, they're going to wiggle us right back in. We're our way back in and we'll be offended. Number three, concentrate. Focus on scriptures on offense to stay strong. Now, the last few weeks, we have given you all kinds of scriptures to hang on to. Isn't it amazing how many scriptures talk about offense? Were you surprised about that? Me too. So concentrate on it. And one of the things that I like to do, and you hear me say this all the time, is get some index cards out and write out in longhand your scriptures. Keep them in your pocket, keep them in your purse, keep them in your car. Those will be your go-to when offense tries to take you. Number four, confront. Confront your own feelings and where those emotions are coming from. It may not always be so obvious. Those emotions may come from somewhere from the past. If you are noticing the same offense is coming up and your feelings are hurt over the same thing over and over, it's important to say, Jesus, what is it? There's something else going on here. What is it? Will you show me what the root of that thing is? Confront anything that the devil is trying to blow it out of proportion. But ask God. That offense may come from a hurt or a trauma way back there somewhere. Find out what it is. Confront it. Give words to it. And lay it down for Jesus to heal it. If you feel like you need some help with an offense that just keeps coming up, get a hold of a godly friend that you trust. That's very important. And help ask that person to help you gain proper perspective. Can we kind of get a little wacky? encounter, confront, is surrender the offense to God. God, I surrender it to you. Help me to see my emotions the way I should. Help me to understand them. I lay them down to you, Jesus. And you may need to ask him, help me, Father. Help me to see things the way I should. I'm not seeing things clearly. Amen. Do you think that would help?
Yes.
I think so too. Now we're going to close, and I want us to be very introspective in our prayer tonight. And we're going to invite the Holy Spirit in to come do his precious work. And he may tap you on your heart about some things that you forgot about, didn't know about, or something that has had center stage way too long. So let's bow our heads. Holy Spirit, we invite you to come in right now. Holy Spirit, penetrate up and down the aisles and the chairs. If there's wounds that we just slapped a band-aid on, will you open them up so we can look at them clearly? Holy Spirit, we invite you in. As the Holy Spirit moves, we begin to submit feelings, emotions, bad feelings about people, begin to lay them down, say, I submit them to you, Father. Forgive me. That's at center stage. Forgive me. And perhaps you need to ask forgiveness for whatever part you play. We do a role in offense. Father, forgive me. I did this. I said this. Thought this, forgive me. Now ask the Holy Spirit to empower you to be healed and whole over this situation. Jesus, come in. Heal the brokenness. Heal the wounds. The wounds of the past. We surrender it all to you. And now just tell him thank you. Thank you, Jesus, for forgiving me and loving me and being patient with me. Father, thank you for this awesome teaching. We love your word. I love your people. And Father, just seal up this word. We love you, Jesus.